I'm Dr. Connie Webster of the Department of Nursing and Health Professions at the University of the District of Columbia. Welcome to Health Matters. Our purpose is to assist you in managing your health care by providing you balanced information and resources to help you make knowledgeable choices about your health. The topic of this program is palliative care. Now, palliative care is a specialized medical care for people with serious illnesses. It focuses on providing patients with relief from symptoms, pain, and stresses of a serious illness, whatever the diagnosis may be. The goal is to improve quality of life for both the patient and the family. Palliative care is provided by a team of doctors, nurses, and other specialists who work together with the patient's other doctors to provide an extra layer of support. It is appropriate at any age and at any stage in a serious illness and can be provided along with curative treatment. And joining me to talk more about palliative care is Anita Brikman. She's the Senior Vice President, Office of Strategic Communication, the National Hospice and Palliative Care Organization. Anita has played an active role in promoting health-related philanthropy organizations. She was the spokesperson for the Leukemia and Lymphoma Society's capital area fundraising campaigns in 2009. She is a longtime advocate of American Heart Association's Go Red and Start Walking initiatives and is currently on the board of directors for the National Kidney Foundation. Anita, welcome to Health Matters.
It is such a pleasure to be here with you.
Oh, it is such a pleasure to have you for more reasons than one. And I guess the greatest reason I will say is because on Health Matters, we usually talk about things that are disease deficits and focus more on how patients can relieve that. But today, we're talking about a whole nother level of healthcare. And I think we're gonna start the program off by having you talk, even though I gave a general description about palliative care, talk about palliative care and have the viewers know how it differs a bit from just total pure hospice care.
I'm so glad you asked that. You gave a great description of palliative care.
Thank you.
It is that support, that kind of cocoon that can go around a patient and a family dealing with a serious illness. Palliative medicine, in particular, really focuses in on pain and symptom management. Palliative care is the whole host of things. It can be a therapist, it can be medication, it can be counseling to help the family. What hospice does is actually palliative care.
Right.
But what is interesting with palliative care is that you are not necessarily in an end-of-life situation. You may be facing a life-limiting or life-threatening illness, and palliative care can help you weather that as you are going through treatments. As we know, sometimes treatments for deadly diseases like cancer, the treatments themselves are very hard to take, very toxic and debilitating. So while your cancer team may be focused on that, or your heart disease team, or whatever it is you're looking at, a palliative care specialist or a team can help you cope. Palliative care is about easing suffering, and hospice in particular is all about putting the patient first, hopefully allowing them to face a life-limiting illness without pain and with dignity. So palliative care is, I guess, anywhere more along the continuum, and hospice practices palliative care within that model.
Yes, and I heard you say two things that I'd like our viewers to take away, and that is the fact that palliative care is actually a part of hospice care. And it can, and it also may occur in hospital settings and long-term care settings and in a variety of settings. And the other thing that I would like for them to hear and remember is the fact that when you spoke about hospice, we were talking about an identified end-of-life situation, and in the literature, and even when we were talking, sometimes the doctor can certify that within 6 months or so, if this is a terminal illness, that the patient might benefit from hospice care.
That's exactly how it works. A doctor will help look at a patient's history, look at where they are on the disease trajectory. And it's not obviously an exact science, but what a doctor can say, or a family member can ask for this as well. A patient can say, is it maybe time for hospice for us? Mm-hmm. I think a lot of times people think they have to wait for the physician or healthcare provider to bring it up. A family can initiate this conversation, but a doctor will look at the typical trajectory of this illness, and if it looks like the prognosis would be that death could be imminent within the next 6 months, hospice is appropriate. This does not cost the family anything. The hospice benefit is a separate benefit under Medicare. It can be delivered in the home, and the idea is for many people, they want to be able to stay
right.
at home.
Those final days in a surrounding that they know their family is available and that's comfortable to them. And since you said that, I would just like to read a wonderful, powerful statement that came from your website. And it states, at the center of hospice and palliative care is the belief that each of us has the right to die pain-free and with dignity. And that's what palliative care and hospice care is all about. Now, in some of the literature, they talk about the team, but tell our viewers more specifically, because some people that are appropriate for palliative care might be people with chronic heart disease, leukemia, some diseases that are not right away terminal, mm-hmm. but with symptoms that can be very debilitating
very.
And can cause a lot of stressors for caregivers. So talk to us a little bit about the team that is actually the palliative care team.
Well, it depends on which model and where. Sometimes if a person has had an exacerbation, an acute situation, and they're in the hospital, and if that person or that family thinks, you know, these symptoms aren't being managed very well, they can actually ask for a palliative care consult.
Right.
Bring that up, talk about it. This is not taking away from what you're doing on a curative level, but you can ask for a consult. There can be an entire team of people, though, that do get involved in this, in both hospice and palliative care.
Right.
You have physicians, you have nurses, but you also have social workers
yeah.
who may address some of the incredible stress of chronic illness and caregiving on a family.
Yes.
You can have spiritual care as part of every hospice experience that is available to people, spiritual or clergy, as part of that. Of course, they can also not have that. That is completely up to each individual. There is no necessity for that.
Right.
There are therapists that get involved, and with hospice in particular, one of the most beautiful things that I've seen since joining this organization is what volunteers do. They go into the homes of families dealing with end of life and give respite to the caregiver. They give friendship,
yes.
companionship.
Yes.
In some cases, we have a program called We Honor Veterans that pairs up volunteers who themselves have served with a patient who has military service. No one understands what a veteran feels like another veteran.
Like another veteran.
Hospice helps pair those people up. And you know, sometimes people have asked me, isn't this a depressing topic?
Oh, wow.
You will never meet more amazingly positive, compassionate, and peaceful people than those that work in hospice. They are amazing.
You're absolutely right. You're absolutely right.
The nurses that I've met and the volunteers, they find it. And we encourage people to reach out to their local hospice and volunteer. You have no idea the benefits you will get by helping someone through this difficult time.
Anita, when we were talking before the show, you mentioned a wonderful initiative that will be coming forth and provided by the Affordable Care Act. Can you share this with the audience? Because I thought that sounded like a wonderful, wonderful opportunity.
Well, we at NHPCO think it's tremendous. It's called concurrent care.
Okay.
And what it means is that a patient would still be able to try maybe one or two more curative treatments, whatever it is, in their illness, but already get the benefits of hospice care, which having that in the home may help them actually do better and prevent the flare-ups that we're talking about.
Yes.
And to have concurrent care, some private insurers already offer this, mm-hmm. and under the Affordable Care Act, it is the law for the pediatric population already.
Right now.
Mm-hmm. But okay. This was just announced that Medicare is going to have test sites in the adult population of concurrent care around the country to show that it can be beneficial for the patient and family, mm-hmm. and cost effective as well. Mm-hmm. I think some critics have thought, well, is this doubling up on the care? But
right.
what we think it will do is actually open the continuum and make it easier for a patient and family. It's hard to say, okay, I'm giving up on the curative approach.
Right.
Maybe one last time, maybe I can try one more thing. If you are already getting support from hospice, the palliative side,
right.
you may end up doing better. And then if the curative treatment doesn't work, that transition has
already been
made. And it is so beneficial, we believe, and we believe it will be cost effective as well. Private insurers have seen it work tremendously well, and we are so thrilled that Medicare is rolling out test sites under the Affordable Care Act.
You know, when you say that, it just makes so much sense, because one other big problem for consumers of healthcare is the complexity of the healthcare system.
I agree.
And you are talking about, with the concurrent care, you're talking about a seamless transition.
Yes.
If indeed I'm already getting both of these levels of care, if at the point that I need total hospice, I'm already halfway familiar with that team, that method
yes.
of care, my family doesn't have to go an extra mile to get this level of support for me. So it just makes all the sense in the world. One other thing, in reference to the test sites, have they maybe identified where those sites might be?
This is just getting rolled out.
Absolutely.
We don't know where they will be, but they will be taking proposals for them, for hospices around the country
oh,
to
wow.
be a part of this.
Wow.
And again, in the pediatric population, it is already the law. Seriously ill children who are getting services through Medicaid can get concurrent care. So if a family has a critically ill child with a cancer or some issue that's congenital, whatever it is, they can continue to get curative treatments, but hospice can come in and support that family, which may actually reduce hospitalizations and costs down the line. I think it is absolutely where we should go.
And you know, when I think about where it has started, it makes all the sense in the world, because as the mother of a child with tetraphilat or any of these other diseases
yes.
that for some may be a death sentence, who wants to give up on their child? So to say, I'm going total hospice, or there's no curative care, exactly what you said would happen. They would keep going with hope that something, as far as cure is concerned, might happen, but having the child still getting the support and the family getting the support of what palliative care would bring to them.
Do you know what's so great that hospice does that I don't think people know, and I hope I can share this? In a case where a mother gets a diagnosis, even in the womb, that a condition could very well be fatal.
Yes.
And that is a horrible thing. It should be the happiest time in your life, and you find out there's something really
yes.
wrong with your baby.
Yes.
And if doctors say there really isn't much that we can do, and the mother decides, you know, but I want to see this through.
Absolutely.
I want to have my child.
Absolutely.
Hospices actually get involved in a perinatal support program. I know we have them here. I know in particular the Gilchrist program in Maryland does tremendous work with Gilchrist kids.
Oh, what a wonderful thing.
The mom is getting support as that baby arrives, and for however long she has that child,
yes.
hospice is there to help support the family, document special moments. It's really tremendous. And these are the nurses, the social workers, the volunteers that go out there. I think sometimes people think hospice is just this place that you go to die.
Mm.
And it's not. It comes to you, and it's not about the very end. It's not just about the last final days. Hospice is about making more life happen as long as possible.
As long as possible. Making your quality, whatever it is, living it to the fullest, as I would say,
mm-hmm.
and providing the family the opportunity to enjoy that person. You said something else that really stuck with me, and I would like for you to share it with the viewers, just as you said it to me. And that is about the people who work in hospice and palliative care.
When I first took this role, some of my friends said, boy, that's great, good for you, but boy, that's gonna be really depressing. And I will tell you that they are some of the most positive and at peace with themselves people I have ever met, because they are there at the most critical times. And there is nothing like being near someone and close to someone at a time close to death to make you realize what you yourself have and what you may not be doing to live to the fullest. I believe they are angels in many ways. And I know I was just visiting with a woman who lives in Northwest DC, not far from this studio, and her hospice nurse was there while we were talking to her about her choice at the end stage of a cancer diagnosis. That woman has been a hospice nurse for 20 years, and she is one of the most beautiful, serene people I've ever met. And that's no bull. That's amazing.
Well, you know, funny you should say that. On a prior show, when we were talking about why people become nurses, so if you see my chest growing, it's because I am so proud of the fact that I am a nurse. And you're mm-hmm. absolutely right. When I looked at oncology nurses and hospice nurses and palliative care nurses, I found out why I really am proud to be a nurse. Who else in what other professions is trained to, number one, usher a new life into this world?
Yes.
And then, this is the part that touches my heart, to sit by a bedside. And my job for that time, for a person who's getting ready to transition, is to make that the most wonderful and peaceful and natural time for them and their family. That is my job. And I said, what other profession? I really, as you said, I'm an angel. I was put here for that special reason, so they are. It's not gloom and doom. It's just making that transition happen for the patient as best and dignified as possible and as less stressful and grieving for the family as you can. So
in this case, this nurse has helped this patient manage her medication. She is at home. She is enjoying her grandbaby.
Yes.
Her pain, there's a whole regimen to make sure there's no breakthroughs mm-hmm. as much as possible. Mm-hmm. Nausea, any issues she has with eating,
yes.
that is dealt with.
Yes.
She's at home, she plays her piano, she reads her books, she spends time with her daughter, her grandchild. Hospice helps make things like that happen. And I think we really do need the American public to understand the vast majority of people end up in hospice care only for just a few days after a doctor has said, I'm sorry, there's nothing more we can do. If we had a more open conversation earlier on about our end of life wishes, mm-hmm. that wouldn't have to happen. That wouldn't have to happen. Let's talk about it earlier
yes.
and look at this. And I do believe concurrent care will help.
Yes,
I do.
Very important statement. Advanced directives, talking to family about what it is you like, what it is you need. Mm-hmm. And I believe in patients being empowered. Also walking into your physician, and once you get that diagnosis and you've gotten to a certain place to say, this is what I'd like to happen. So they have to take control as well. Mm-hmm. I want you to do two things for me. First, if you can share any resources, because this is a very important part
yes.
of our program and for our viewers. If there are any resources or any things or places that you feel that they must know before we leave today. And I'm going to ask you to do some other things to help people start to think about the kinds of things they'd like families to know or anyone to know in terms of palliative care.
Well, I would like to start by inviting everyone to go to caringinfo.org.
Caringinfo.org.
Okay. Yes. And it is our Caring Connections website. On this site are a tremendous amount of resources, everything from explanations of hospice and palliative care to managing pain, to caregiver stress, to advanced directives, living wills, all that kind of discussion. And we have templates that are actually the advanced directives state by state. They are free right there on the website. And it's more than even just having an advanced directive. It's having a conversation.
Yes.
And this can be years before anyone gets sick.
Yes.
We have a phrase we use, who speaks for you?
That is right.
Who speaks for you? If all of a sudden there's a terrible car accident,
right.
Someone has a stroke,
yes.
a brain aneurysm,
yes.
there can be a myriad of things that come up out of the blue that we can't plan for.
Right.
Who speaks for you?
Right.
Who knows
right.
what you really want? Do you want a feeding tube? Do you want to be on a respirator?
Right.
What kind of choices? Unfortunately, sometimes in the heat of a crisis, as you know from the medical field, these choices have to be made. But if there's no advanced directive or discussion
right.
about what the patient wants,
right.
it's much harder at that critical time to
do it. Especially for family.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you're treading dangerous waters. You want to do what's best,
yes.
but it's best to do what that loved one wants.
Exactly. And it may be very different than what you think they want.
Absolutely.
And having the conversation when you're not ill. So we often talk about the holidays when everyone's gathered. I mean, you don't want to be a downer, but someone needs to start that
yes.
conversation.
Yes.
I'm healthy now. I'm here enjoying my pumpkin pie with
yes.
you. But I want you to know something.
Yes.
I want you to know that if I'm in a vegetative state.
Yes. Yes.
What's going to come?
Yes.
And you don't need to wait to have the conversation.
Yes.
Who speaks with you? Who speaks for you? And
right.
what is it you would like?
Right.
And it's not... You give your family members a gift by yeah. having that conversation.
Absolutely.
Because you are not leaving them in a quandary at
yes.
that point of not knowing what to do.
Yes.
So we can all prepare. We can all have the conversation.
Yes.
And we can think about hospice and palliative care as part of the care continuum.
That's
not something
right.
to avoid.
That is right.
Excuse me.
And for any other resources or any places that persons may go that are disadvantaged or underserved, anything that you can offer up to this population?
Our Caring Connections website really has PDFs that are specific
mm-hmm.
to certain communities.
Mm-hmm.
There's also information on how to initiate these kind of conversations or engage. Maybe you're very close to your spiritual community.
Yes.
Is this something that could become a discussion at your church? You may be helping people in ways you don't even know.
That is true.
We have information outreach guides that are very specific to the African American and Hispanic and other ethnic communities because people approach end of life care very differently, and some people also have a suspicion of hospice, of someone coming into your home.
Mm-hmm.
But it is my belief that having that conversation earlier on and understanding what hospice really is
mm-hmm.
and that these team of people are not there to take over but to support
right.
what your wishes and your cultural mores are.
Yes.
Then I think you have a different view of it. But it's finding out ahead of time. Once someone's in a hospital, once you're at the bedside and trying to decide what to do,
right.
it is a very hard time to figure all of this out.
Mm.
I would really encourage everyone to just check out caringinfo.org
mm-hmm.
because whether you're caring for an ailing person, whether you're completely healthy, whether you know someone in pain,
right.
whether you have a coworker who
right.
may be dealing with a death and you need to know how do you talk to someone who's grieving,
mm-hmm.
that information is there.
I think that your recommendation about church groups is very important.
Mm-hmm.
There are generally different ministries within
mm-hmm.
a church. And as my pastor says, every Sunday, no one knows what another is going through. And so sometimes when people won't come to you and tell you the kinds of pain and suffering that maybe they are undergoing or that loved ones are undergoing,
mm-hmm.
if we could just be more open to discussing what is available and that you really don't have to be on your deathbed in order for some symptoms to be relieved, like if you're a severe asthmatic or
mm-hmm.
COPD, chronic obstructive disease
mm-hmm.
or have congestive heart failure and those things, it's all about making you have a quality of life based on relief of those symptoms.
And part of that can be as well some counseling, because if you look at COPD or something, how stressful it is.
Absolutely.
To deal with this. You can't
yes.
breathe.
You cannot breathe.
What if you have anxiety or depression because of this? The palliative care model says we're not going to say you need to go somewhere else and figure
no.
that out.
Go
we're
see.
Going to say we're going to look at the whole picture. And maybe we need, if your anxiety is better controlled, if you have someone to talk to, if you're part of a support group, maybe your health will be better. It is a mind-body experience, as we know. And I think addressing that earlier on is so important. But we as a culture cannot be death-denying.
Yes.
That is the other thing.
Yes.
Medicine has made tremendous progress.
Wonderful, wonderful.
And we have done so much with infection control,
yes.
with surgical techniques, with oncology. We are so blessed in that way. But there will be an end or a transition, however we choose to
yes,
look at it for
yes,
all of us.
Yes.
And not thinking about it, not planning for it, and not talking about it doesn't help.
Does not make it go away. As a matter of fact, as a healthcare provider, I think the most positive times during a terminal illness situation is when I have a family member in there that says, I know what my mom wants, or yeah. I know what my dad wants. As opposed to a family that's there going, we don't know what to do. We never talked about this. So that is a gift for family members to share. And the other thing that I think is so wonderful about the whole of this is the involvement of family. When we talk about cultural differences, just the big culture, there are also these intercultural
yes.
family differences that those family members can bring. Say something to those caregivers before we go.
Caregiver stress is very, very real. And we're only really delving into what that means for people on a health perspective.
Yes.
Mentally, NHPCO is very much about providing support and resources even outside of hospice care as part of the palliative care continuum. And for the caregiver, what this means is making sure that as you're caring for this loved one, you're not stopping caring for yourself. No one benefits if you're not eating well, if you can't sleep.
Right.
No one benefits if you cut yourself off from your friends and don't ask for help.
Right.
And as our population ages, we are going to have more long-term caregivers.
Mm-hmm.
The chronic illness continuum is longer than it used to be,
mm-hmm.
and caregivers need help. They need our help, but they also need to be open to receiving it and for taking care of themselves.
You are absolutely right. Thank you so much. I ask one thing of you as we are about to close. If you hear one of those sites coming up for concurrent care, might be in DC, get back to us.
I'll be back.
Health Matters is a television series to assist you in managing your health care. If you would like more information about the National Hospice and Palliative Care Organization, visit their website at www.nhpco.org. If our discussion, however, has challenged you to consider health care as a profession, consider the University of the District of Columbia's Department of Nursing and Health Professions and visit our website at www.udc.edu. I'm Dr. Connie Webster. Thank you for watching. And remember, your health matters.